Hi, everybody. Thanks for coming to this CAR seminar. Today, we have the pleasure of having Dr. Rebecca Hamilton to give a presentation. Rebecca is still affiliated, I think, to the School of Culture, History, and Language here in CAP, if I'm not mistaken, but her main affiliation is now with the Max Planck Institute for the Science of Human History. And her work focuses on combining paleo-environmental data with historical data to reconstruct past landscapes and better understand the impact of human populations on the environment. So today, specifically, the talk will be about conserving Australia's misremembered natural heritage, the need for a long-term perspective. So without further ado, I'll let you go, Rebecca, whenever you're ready.
Okay, thank you. Okay, fantastic. So I'll just quickly apologize at the start. I don't know if any of you paid attention to the initial talk topics, but this one's quite a detour from what I had originally intended to present. So I hope that's okay. Before I get started, I just would like to acknowledge the traditional owners of the lands where this research was conducted, the Gadigal and Ngarrawal people. And in particular, I would like to thank my colleague, Dr. Shane Ingray, who's provided a significant amount of input with respect to traditional ecological knowledge for this project. I'll also acknowledge my research advisor, Dan Penny, who's provided a lot of input into this talk. And also would like to thank the State Library of New South Wales, who actually funded a fellowship for me in 2019. Which allowed me to undertake all the historical analyses that I'll be showing today. Before I jump into the actual specifics of Sydney swamplands, I just wanted to contextualize why swamps are actually important to study. And this is through a very sort of hard evaluation lens, but I'll just draw your attention to this plot on the right-hand side of the screen. And you'll note that swamps and estuaries have significantly higher value in dollars per hectare per year than other landscapes which we might conventionally consider to be high value, such as forests, lakes and rivers. And this is largely because of their role in factors such as improving water quality, or as we've all experienced recently, their role in flood mitigation, as well as a range of other ecosystem services. But despite these, human cultures worldwide still too often consider swamplands to be wastelands that should be drained for disease control, and they're commonly converted to agricultural or urban landscapes, which is the case with the swamplands I'll be talking about today. So with that in mind, the story that I'm telling today begins at a little swamp remnant called Lachlan Swamp, which is a small site around 1.7 hectares, which is located in the centre of Centennial Park in Sydney. For those of you who are not familiar with Centennial Park, it's a large green space shown here in the green shading, located around 4 kilometres southeast of Sydney CBD. And Lachlan Swamp is just this tiny little red dot in the middle of Centennial Park. And just to contextualise the sort of region that I'll be talking about for most of this talk, it's the zone extending between Sydney Harbour and Botany Bay in Sydney. And I'll be referring to this grey zone generally as South Sydney. If you've ever taken a turn of Centennial Park, you might recognise the Lachlan Swamp remnant as the backdrop to wedding photos, which are commonly taken along this bridge, which goes across the lily pond, or else you might notice it as the forested landscape where hundreds of flying foxes roost during the day. But if you've ever braved walking underneath these flying foxes, which can be quite risky, you'll notice that the site is actually considered to be of exceptionally high conservation value. And this is enshrined in the plan of management for the park, where it's mandated that the wetlands should be managed as a predominantly natural pre-European landscape setting of environmental significance with strong cultural significance that encourages visitor awareness of its sensitive natural and heritage values. And this is conveyed to the user of this wetland where pathways and fences protect what is considered to be very sensitive natural vegetation. The historical significance of this wetland is very tightly coupled to the hydrogeological setting of it. So historically, the Lachlan Swamp, which again is just shown in this little red dot up here, served as Sydney's second water source for the British colony of Sydney between the 1820s and 1880s, where pressure in the tank stream and a series of droughts saw managers of the town looking elsewhere to afford a reliable source of fresh water. And prior to European settlement, we know that these swamps were heavily utilised by Indigenous people for their fresh water. And the role of this site for providing ample fresh water is largely related to the geology of the region. So this map is a geological map of South Sydney, and the pale yellow unit in this map represents thick quaternary sand deposits, which essentially act as a large sponge and host abundant supplies of fresh water. And this saw the region supporting a series of swamps that drained from what is now the upper margin of Centennial Park in the north, all the way down to Botany Bay. And in addition to this significant historical and geological value, the site is perhaps most significantly considered to be of high value because it is thought to preserve one of the last remnants of Indigenous swamp vegetation in the region. Currently, this vegetation community is thought to comprise in the canopy swamp paperbark or Melaleuca quinquennavia, which is this guy here with a peely bark. And this currently makes up around 90% of the canopy cover of the site. And in the understory around the swamp edges, there are a lot of sedges, garnia, and also ground ferns shown here. And some of the secondary species within this unit comprise swamp oaks, casuarina glauca, swamp mahogany, and also tree ferns. And the value of this assemblage goes far beyond the site at Lachlan Swamp. This site is actually expected to be a remnant of the original swamp vegetation across the aquifer. So that pale yellow unit, which here is bounded by this black line. And the conspicuous species within this assemblage is thought to be Melaleuca quinquennavia, or that swamp paperbark. And this assemblage is protected as what is called an endangered ecological community under New South Wales environmental legislation. And while the remnants today are thought to be quite small, it's expected that this assemblage was relatively common across southern Sydney. This map that I've shown here shows in the coloured dots last remnants of pre-European flora, or what is thought to represent pre-European flora across the Sydney basin. And all the grey shading sort of represents the current urban fingerprint of the landscape. And these two green units here represent these freshwater swamp units within Sydney. And you'll notice that they are tiny, or you might not even notice because it's so small. But there is a small remnant up at the Lachlan Swamp site in Centennial Park. And there are a couple of patches down further south in the catchment here. And this is the Botany Water Reserves, which actually served as the third water supply for Sydney, colonial Sydney. And this is also protected under state environmental legislation. But the problem with classifying pre-European vegetation, particularly in these very urbanized landscape, is that in the absence of long-term data, long-term environmental data, we're protecting landscapes without actually having evidence of what the landscape looked like in the past. And so that inspired my collaborators and I to draw on the framework of historical ecology to piece together the actual history of the Sydney freshwater wetlands. So this is a multidisciplinary approach, which as described by Crumley is particularly useful within urban landscapes that have been largely overprinted by development and also have been strongly influenced by shifting social values through time. So there's a couple of disciplines that we sort of relied upon for reconstructing the historical ecology of the Sydney freshwater swamplands. The first of them is paleoecology, which we used at the Lachlan Swamp site back in 2010. And I'm assuming most of you here are probably familiar with paleoecology, but I'll just give a very, very quick summary of what it is. So essentially there's the pollen from trees, angiosperms and gymnosperms, as well as spores from ferns, are released from the parent vegetation and accumulate in wetland sediments through time. Fossil pollen and spores can be isolated from sediments of known ages, and these are, of course, dated using radiometric techniques such as radiocarbon dating. And importantly, pollen and spores from different species are different shapes, so we can start to associate the pollen type with the parent vegetation back through time. So, for example, the pollen from the freshwater paper bark, Melaleuca quinquennalia, looks quite different under the light microscope to that of Casuarina glauca, which again looks quite different from, for example, some of these ground ferns that we see at the Lachlan Swamp site. So we use these techniques from a short core around 40 centimetres depth that we extracted from the wetland and use that to produce pollen diagrams. Don't worry, this is the only one that I'm including today. So just for some context here, the y-axis is sediment depth, which represents time. And I've overlaid two key time frames on this diagram. 1788 is the timing where the first European colony settled in Sydney. And 1888 is the timing where the Lachlan Swamp was converted from the water reserve to Centennial Park. And what you'll notice about the pre and early European flora of the site is that it predominantly comprises taxa from the Apocridaceae family. So something that looks like this, a low heathy plant, and also a large component of the flora was made up of rushes, which are these wetland plants. Importantly, there was very few forest taxa in the pre and early European period. The only sort of dominant tree taxa we get during this time period is from Casuarina, but they still make up a relatively low component of the vegetation count, suggesting that they were probably quite sporadic across the landscape. But after European contact, and particularly after the establishment of Centennial Park at the site, we start to see a rapid increase in this swamp paper bark or Melaleuca quinquennalia from very negligible background values in the pre-European flora. And what that suggests is that this current Melaleuca quinquennalia dominated canopy is actually quite a modern assemblage. And that's particularly interesting if you look at the timing of 1960 on this map, where we see this rapid expansion in Melaleuca quinquennalia, suggesting that this sort of what we see at the site today really is a very modern assemblage sort of within the lifespan of many people. And you can actually notice this from aerial images of the site. And this is a little bit galling when I pulled out these images and I was writing up the site. So you could actually see in a moment what took me the best part of a year to reconstruct from my honours thesis. You'll note here that the current vegetation of the Lachlan Swamp site, shown in this dotted white boundary, is quite dense, which is quite different from what we see in 1970 and in 1951 in particular. And this corresponds really well with what we see in the pollen record, which is this increase in canopy cover sometime between these two timeframes. So overall, the paleoecology part of this study showed that the vegetation at the Lachlan Swamp site today doesn't sort of at all resemble what was there in the pre and early European period, where the vegetation was a much more open, heathy, landscape, which looked something probably a lot more like this than like this. And this raised a couple of interesting lessons. So first of all, environmental memory can be incredibly short, even within these heavily populated areas, which really raises the question of how we managed to so poorly mischaracterize this landscape, which today is protected under environmental legislation. Is this because the past vegetation at the swamp is an anomaly, or does the pollen record that we see at that one site reflect the swamplands of South Sydney and that aquifer more broadly? How extensive were these swamplands across space? So was the vegetation sort of continuous across the area or not? And if they were continuous, how has the hydrology of the area been altered with urbanisation? And then ultimately, what do all of these questions mean for the future management of these swamp remnants? So to address these questions, we turn to the historical record. And as I stated in the first slide, a lot of the work that I undertook for this was funded by the State Library of New South Wales. And I also want to acknowledge that I'm certainly not the first person to draw on historical data to make landscape interpretations for this region. There's other prominent researchers such as Benson and Howell, Ashton and others who've undertaken some really great work with respect to the environmental history of Sydney. And that's been very useful for this project. So in trying to piece together the environmental history of this South Sydney region more broadly, I used GIS techniques where I referenced map data, historical images, paintings, text in space, and then collated these into different timeframes to produce environmental maps. So the first question on the previous slide, which was perhaps the easiest to address using these historical data, were how extensive were the freshwater swamplands in the past? Were they tiny in the area, or were they a very representative part of the area? And how has the hydrology of the system of Southern Sydney changed with urbanisation? So the first step in doing this was to reconstruct a digital elevation model of the topography of the region prior to extensive urbanisation. The earliest map which permitted this reconstruction came from 1894 and was produced by the Department of Lands. And if you zoom in on this map, which is quite large, you'll see there's a lot of really high resolution contour data produced for this map. So what I did was take these contour data and literally trace all of them in space, which was my coronavirus lockdown task last year. And then use these contour data to produce a digital elevation model, which is shown by the colored backing on these images, which you can see quite nicely constrains this Southern Sydney aquifer zone. And then from the digital elevation model, we applied flow pathway modelling to reconstruct the drainage of the site prior to urbanisation. And what you'll note is that the catchment in 1894 drained from the northeast to southwest in five main arms, here, 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 and here. I then applied the same techniques to contemporary topographical data, which is accessible and from New South Wales DPI. And what you'll notice is when you conduct the same flow pathway modelling onto the contemporary digital elevation model, the flow pathways are significantly fragmented. And this is because the relatively subtle topography of the catchment means that flow drainage pathways now typically follow roads, as you can kind of see if you zoom in on this image, which suggests that urbanisation has probably had quite a significant impact on the hydrology of the swamplands, which is not particularly surprising. The second step to answer these questions was to map the swamp extents. The most useful data from maps that enabled this process came from the 1820s onwards, because the 1820s was around the time where the swamplands were looked at as being a viable water source for the colony of Sydney. So this entailed collecting a whole bunch of historical maps and georeferencing them. And the boundaries of swamplands are pretty nicely shaded on some of these historic maps. This one's from 1850. And then there were also some sort of more zoomed in close-ups of swamplands. So this one, for instance, comes from the northwest portion of the catchment. So a similar process to the contours, you georeference them, you trace the boundaries of the swamps. And then from that, we were able to produce a map of the swamp boundaries within the sort of early European period, which in this time frame extends from 1820 to 1853. So this map, I'll just for the moment have a look at the blue polygons, and these are the locations of the swamp boundaries. And the important takeaway from this map is that the swamp area during this early European period was incredibly extensive across South Sydney. They comprised a total of 11 kilometres squared, so we're pretty representative of the zone. And that's significantly different when you look back at the contemporary map of water bodies, which in this map are shown by the blue shading, and they're significantly reduced in extent today than they were in the past. Interestingly, however, though the two protected swampland sites, including the Lachlan swamp site in the northern portion of the catchment and the Botany swamp sites, which is what I refer to as the third water source, are actually relatively well preserved in morphology today. So the boundaries match pretty well between the historic data and the present data. And then we produced the same swamp extent maps for 1880 to the 1930s using the Department of Lands map showed earlier, as well as some beautiful parish maps, which were produced by Higginbotham and Rotham, just including them because they're really lovely to look at. And from those, we produced this secondary map. Again, the blue polygons represent the swamp extent. And what you should notice in comparing the early European map from the later European map is that the swamp extent is significantly reduced in this time frame from around 11 kilometres squared to around 7 kilometres squared. And this is due to an interaction of over-extraction of the water resources as well as the development of industry in these areas, which I'll come back to later. So in terms of those questions posed, a couple of slides ago, we know from this reconstruction that the Sydney freshwater swamplands were very extensive in southern Sydney in the past, comprising around 11 square kilometres. And while urbanisation has fragmented the flow pathways for the swamplands, the protected sites today, Lachlan Swamp and Botany Swamps, actually preserve the integrity of the original pre and early British swamplands quite well. Now with those data produced, we were then able to see whether or not what we see in the pollen data at the Lachlan Swamp site in the northern part of the catchment is continuous across the South Sydney area more broadly. And for this, we drew again on historical maps as well as written texts and images. So unfortunately, the early European period doesn't have a lot of mapped data, but we can get an impression of the South Sydney vegetation from some of the early written descriptions. So when Cooks and Banks first arrived in Botany Bay, Cooks described some of the finest meadows in the world, while Banks described knee-high brushes of plants stretching over gentle and importantly treeless hills as far as the eye can see. With this very basic map annotation describing southern Sydney as sandy, barren country, certainly gives the impression that the landscape was open and certainly not forested. And while Philip, who was the first governor of the colony of Sydney, described the vegetation in less favourable terms, we get a similar interpretation of the overall landscape. So he described unhealthy swamplands within the Botany Bay region, which in fact was the reason why the first British colony was moved from Botany Bay to its current location. Some of the early explorers, including Watkin Tench in the 1790s, described the landscape as comprising high coarse rushes growing in a rotten spongy bog into which we plunged knee deep at every step. This, as well as again, these basic map annotations, which in southern Sydney, again, describe the landscape as comprising barren sands and sandy and barren country, again, give the impression of this very open landscape. The time frame between 1820 and 1870, as with the hydrological data, produced a lot more ecological data that could actually be referenced into the environmental maps. So map data was generally very generic in its description, and these have been overlaid on this early European map in this green font. So we have dense scrub, tea tree scrub, scrub, scrub. Literally scrub everywhere was the description. Again, giving the impression of an open landscape. Some of the more useful data in terms of reconstructing the composition of the flora came from written resources. So this quote from Frederick Mackey, who undertook a walk from Waterloo Swamp all the way down to Botany Bay, describes the road as going over low sand hills covered with small scrub and various flowers. So overall an open landscape. Importantly, this description does describe that the flora compositionally comprised of Ericaceae taxa. And this description from here actually corresponds quite well with what we see in the pollen record from Lachlan Swamp, which I've summarized for this time frame using this pie chart. And you can see that at this time point, Ericaceae still makes up a relatively large portion of the flora. Interestingly as well, you'll notice that the portion of Restianaceae, which is rushes, corresponds quite well with Tench's description of the landscape. Another particularly useful resource for actually visualizing what the landscape looked like during this time period comes from paintings and sketches, as well as photographs taken during this time frame. These are annotated on the map in letters, and they look something like this. So this image was drawn at Lachlan Swamp. You can see it's relatively open in the foreground and background with a couple of trees. This image was taken from Randwick Racecourse, just south of the swamplands. Again, a very open landscape. This third image comes from the vicinity of the Botany Swamps. Again, a very open landscape. And so on and so forth across the entire catchment, which actually give a relatively representation of spatially representative interpretation of an open landscape. So combined, these historic data demonstrate that what we see in the Lachlan Swamp pollen record is probably continuous across the Botany aquifer catchment and southern Sydney. Importantly, there's no evidence for a swamp paperbark forest in any of these descriptions or paintings. And this then raises the question of how we managed to misremember this landscape given that it was so extensive across the area. It is interesting that the original landscape isn't being particularly well reflected in environmental legislation or conservation policy. And this essentially seems to come down to shifting attitudes coupled with overexploitation of the swamplands during the 19th century. So specifically, the swamplands were alternatively ignored or over-regulated as they shifted between being seen as unhealthy swampscapes to important water resources. So I've just tried to summarize that over the sort of first less than 100 years of European settlement in Sydney. So in 1770, we have Cook's describing the finest meadows in the world. 18 years later, we have the sites described as unhealthy and unfit for development by Phillips. In 1810, the swamplands were set aside as the Sydney Common, so were used for grazing cattle, which would have compacted the soils and altered the vegetation, presumably, or at least the hydrology of the swamplands quite significantly. Then in 1820s, we have the Lachlan Water Reserve, where Centennial Park is today, being described as most likely to afford an abundant supply of soft, fresh water. This was after a period of droughts in the 1820s. And similarly, the 1850s saw the opening of the Botany Swamps water scheme in the southern portion of the catchment after pressures on the Lachlan Water Reserve caused it to diminish its supply. And all the while, this happened with the development of industry in a relatively unregulated manner across the catchment. And these industrial points are mapped on the sort of early 19th century and late 19th century to early 20th century environmental maps. Here, the industry is represented by the little coloured dots. You might be able to make out what these coloured dots represent in the legend down here. But two interesting things happened throughout this time period. So in the central, in the northeastern channel where Waterloo Swamp is, we see a few industries being built in the early 19th century, which then hugely expand by the 1870s to 1930s. And a lot of these industries are incredibly polluting. So they include boiling down works and tanneries. And this wonderful text, The Royal Commission into Noxious and Offensive Trades, describes the significant impact that these industries had downstream. So for all of the swamps draining south and Cook's River, which then flows out into Botany Bay. The central line we see in the early phase, I'll just click backwards, the establishment of water intensive industries during the early 19th century. And these are then removed as the swamplands are progressively dammed and used as a freshwater resource, which does have an impact on the hydrological boundaries, particularly in Lachlan Swamp. And then finally, we see the establishment of market gardens within the southern portion of the catchment, which is apparently a little bit more fertile than the northern portion of the catchment, which resulted in the complete drainage of this quite extensive veteran swamp. And also we have descriptions from newspaper articles describing the pollution that co-occurred with these market gardens, including the application of a lot of fertilizers in this zone. So in addition to those shifting values of the entire swamplands, something interesting also happens within Centennial Park, which is where we have this representative ecosystem of the Sydney freshwater wetlands, or supposedly representative ecosystem of the Sydney freshwater wetlands. Park construction in 1888, which actually is shown in these images and also just really highlights how open and barren the land actually was, involved initially the clearing of native vegetation and replacement with trees that were then valued by the first gardener, including pines and figs. But because of the barren, sandy nature of the catchment, these plantings actually failed. And we have descriptions of the second gardener, Joseph Maiden, actively planting out Melaleuca cucurbita as windbreaks in Centennial Park in 1896. So it is plausible that this or else expansion of tree planting regimes, perhaps after World War II, saw the encroachment and establishment of Melaleuca cucurbita at the park, which were then assumed to be part of the original native vegetation rather than being deliberately cultivated in the area as these windbreaks. So in terms of the question of how did we come to forget the flora so quickly, it seems that rapidly shifting attitudes towards the swamps and unregulated development resulted in certainly a lot of fragmentation of the landscape in the early phase. And we also see a complete lack of efforts to protect the swamplands extending well into the early 20th century. And finally, we generally see a lack of consultation with people who have a more intimate and detailed knowledge of the landscape. And this is very well articulated in Paul Irish's book written about Sydney and the Aboriginal people of Sydney. And here he describes that though the Aboriginal people in Sydney have maintained a strong bond with the coast and its resources, they've largely been ignored in colonial narratives and arguably also in conservation policy. And this brings us to the third piece of the historical ecology pie, which is something we're still actively working on. But in talking with my colleague, Shane Ingray, who has long, deep connections to the land, a lot of the traditional plants that were used and are still used by Indigenous communities today actually reflect the pollen record quite well, suggesting that there is a lot of insight that can be gleaned from the traditional ecological knowledge for informing conservation. So just as a couple final thoughts, all urban landscapes will have long human environmental legacies. And this requires a long-term perspective that not only draws on the physical sciences, but also the social sciences. And this is really important for the management of these sites, particularly when we're looking at the conservation of sites that are presumed to reflect historic benchmarks, such as pre-European flora. And also in terms of the future development of conservation policy, this type of work perhaps indicates that preservation of these wilderness ideas or pre-European flora ideas are perhaps not especially pragmatic in these sites, which actually indicates that we require the application of more normative science, engaging how people value landscapes and what they actually want to conserve in these regions, which are increasingly urbanized, and access to green spaces is at a shortage in these zones. So I'll just quickly acknowledge the people who contributed to this project, of whom there were many, particularly the wonderful staff at the State Library of New South Wales, who brought out countless maps for me to look at, and also some of my paleo-ecological mentors, including Scott Mooney and Mike McPhail from AU. So with that, I will open to questions. Perhaps stop sharing my screen.
Thank you, Rebecca. That was really good. Thank you. Before we move on to the questions, I should probably say that this talk is recorded and will be put on our YouTube channel, as you might have seen in the email I sent last week. I just put the link in the comments. But what I wanted to say now is that if you have a question and you don't feel comfortable from ending up on YouTube, just let me know and I'll trim the video and I'll cut out the question. So anybody with questions? I can start with one to break the ice. Because you've worked in a different environment in the world, in different places, do you think, it's probably hard to generalize, but do you think this short environmental memory is universal? Is it a common thing, or is this case example an exception, do you reckon?
I think it's a largely universal thing, but I think it's particularly problematic in these so-called new world places that often see relatively recently colonized by Europeans and still have these kind of notions of pre-European wilderness. But certainly in a lot of sort of top-down global level conservation policy, such as is proposed in a couple of recent articles like Protect the Last of the Wild or some of the WWF biodiversity hotspot classifications, we see a lot of descriptions of these high value sites being representative of pristine, relatively unimpacted landscapes. But I think more and more archaeological research in these spaces is demonstrating that these sort of high value places have been largely impacted by people over thousands of years. So I hope that we move away from it. But certainly it seems to be a bit of a colonial hangover in Australia to try and protect these sort of intact, stable state Indigenous landscapes.
Yeah, it's amazing that that was only 100 years ago, or people just... nobody knows what the landscape was. I mean, the Aboriginal communities know what the landscape looks like, but that information was lost in such a short amount of time. Rachel, I think you have your hand up.
Hi. Thanks. That was a really, really interesting talk. I was wondering, it's a bit of a random question, but you know how there's all the ideas about introducing extinct species and rewilding? Would you ever consider, say, for example, cutting down all the trees, getting rid of all the trees from the Lachlan Park and trying to make it into what was there originally? Is that anything that anybody has ever proposed? Or?
Well, I think there's probably two points about that argument, because I think this study really demonstrates that that people need to make value judgments about what they actually want to conserve. So if, for instance, there's a consensus that people living in the area or the traditional owners want to bring back an historical landscape, then we can actually start to make informed decisions about it. But having said that, those Apacris open swamplands are really, the flora is very adapted to nutrient poor sandy soils. And right now, particularly in the middle of Centennial Park, they have been incredibly polluted. I just don't think there's any way that you could recreate those past communities without, you know, fundamentally removing urban landscapes from the area. But at the same time, it's like what's being protected at the Centennial Park site, though it is a habitat for eastern grey flying foxes, is actually a really low diversity landscape. So, I mean, they might want to consider potentially bringing back or introducing other species that might be useful from a biodiversity or ecosystem services perspective.
Okay, so it's more like trying to get people to move away from like a concept that this needs to be preserved exactly as it is to something that is more like you can actually do something with this because this is a completely
artificial landscape.
Artificial landscape anyway.
Yeah, I mean, but if people like the artificial landscape,
yeah, then keep
it. But, you know, make an informed judgment about that rather than, yeah, just assuming that it represents this historic value. Or maybe the imagined landscape is what's so valuable about it. It's interesting. I feel like it would be really useful to do some contemporary survey work with the residents of Southern Sydney to see what they value about their landscapes.
Thanks.
There's a question from Jim Speck in the chat. He doesn't have a mic. He says he apologises. But can you discuss how the animal populations have changed, especially with new habitats offering new opportunities?
How the animal communities have changed over the same time period? So I haven't done a whole heap on the fauna, but I have anecdotally noticed quite a lot of descriptions by early bird watchers from the region. So originally they described teal, snipe and the black duck as occurring in these wetlands, which are still, I believe, relatively common birds in the area. They seem to be generalists, but if there's bird watchers in the audience, you can correct me there. There's also a lot of descriptions of a lot of snakes. I don't have any species data for it, and reptiles in these sites, which have probably been pretty largely wiped out with urbanization. But that's all I've got on the fauna.
All right, excellent. Do we have one last question? I see Jack, who unmuted himself. Do you want to say something?
Thanks, Rebecca. It was really interesting. Looking at it, your recent maps showing the hydrology and whatnot, it all makes Sydney look like a countryside when you know, we realize it's basically all concrete. A lot of the hydrology, I would assume, has gone underground. It's in sewers and waterworks that have been built and redirected. And so I wonder how much of the modern flows that you were comparing things against are, I don't know, sort of independent of the elevation that you used to develop your map.
Yeah, I think you have a pretty valid point in that space. Interestingly, I do wonder if more water would have gone underground prior to urbanization, because you have this large aquifer, which presumably absorbed water pretty quickly because it would have been pervious. Whereas now so much of this surface is impervious. So you probably get a lot more runoff from the roads today. Yeah, these are all interesting points to consider. I guess ultimately though, the fact that the boundaries of the wetlands today are relatively intact, and the fact that wetlands are sort of notoriously good for capturing runoff pollutants and mitigating sort of peak floods, which are exacerbated by road runoff, would probably actually play into the idea of the need to conserve what's actually left. Yeah, Campbell?
I had a question very like Jack's, but I was also wondering about the export of water in the 1820s as to some extent draining the swamp. The whole issue of hydrology and runoff and so forth is clearly important.
Yeah. So
measuring the, or estimating the water that's been exported from the swamp, as it were.
Yeah. So I haven't actively measured that. That would be quite an interesting thing to look at, because the Lachlan swamp was drained, or was the water was transferred from the Lachlan swamp to Sydney colony via Busby's bore. But I suspect from what I've mostly read from the region that a lot of the fragmentation of the swamps actually comes from compaction of the soil and drainage. I think it would be really hard to try and decouple outflow rates with the impact of cattle and people in the region at the same time, because I think you'd have to somehow try to counterbalance those two processes. But certainly, I mean, you look at Lachlan Swamp before the water resource and then after the resource, and it was dammed, and the current extent of it is sort of tiny compared to what it was beforehand. And you do have all these descriptions of the fact that it was just over-extracted, and all of these illegal industries being developed on the water stream as well, which were all incredibly water-intensive industries as well. So I suppose you could create estimates from them, but that probably requires a more numerical person than myself to do.
Yeah, sorry, I couldn't find my mouse. But there's one last question in the chat from Robert. Do you want me to read it, or can you see the chat?
I can't see the chat.
Right, okay.
It's not on the public chat.
Oh, I see. Given that this is the oldest settled area of Sydney and there may be many families of multi-generational residents there, might there be potential for European oral histories and diaries to further eliminate local environmental changes?
100%. So interestingly, my father-in-law grew up in this area, and I sort of was talking about this work to him, and he was like, yeah, of course, it was an open scrubland. So it is interesting. It is certainly there in the memory of people, and it's reflected in newspaper articles. I'm sure journals would be a great place to look for European oral histories as well. It's so weird to me that what is being protected as an EEC is being protected as an EEC, given the continuous, quite significant occupation of the area over the past 200 years.
Yeah, I agree. All right. Well, I think that's it. Yeah, thanks. Thanks a lot, Rebecca. That was pretty good. Thanks for everybody to show up. Yeah, like I said, the talk will be put on YouTube. And next week we have another seminar, same time, 3:30, from Alice Barron. She'll be giving her final talk for her PhD. She works with a micro CT, like a 3D scanner, and looks at so there might be cool images next week. So feel free to join us. But in the meantime, yeah, thank you, Rebecca, and enjoy the long weekend, everybody.
Bye, thank you.
See ya.